Okay, it's recording.
Cool. Great.
And which view do you want me to record? The gallery?
Speaker view. Speaker view. Okay. Yeah, because gallery view is going to be like, it'll be all the people. I mean, you know, feel free to put it on gallery view just to be like, look at all these cool people. Hello.
Oh, it's so embarrassing, my room.
I was just cleaning my room really fast. It's like meditating, right? Oh, that's great. I'm going to have to get these.
Okay, you can mute me now.
No, I think people will want to talk to you. You should stay unmuted. Oh. Just guessing. I said we'd be socializing, so okay. I suspect that people will be excited to see you.
Hey.
Cool. Okay. So one of the things, so I'll probably end up saying this like a zillion times just as people filter in, which I think is fine. Does anyone here have, hi, Natalie. Good morning.
Hi guys, always.
Oh, Australia.
Wow. Natalie's joining us from Australia, but has to go to work in an hour, so we'll only be here briefly. But yeah, there are people. See, okay. So I wanted to explain the towel roll-up situation. So basically, I take two towels. So if you only have one, that works fine. So I have two towels, and I fold them in half, the long, so that it's very long. And then I kind of not quite half that again so that there's a little hanging off the end. And then I roll towards that like this. This is my towel roll. Now, let's see. Some people will be putting these on like a bed or a couch. I imagine some people will be putting this on a chair or something like that. So you can put that down like this. And it's a little bit short for Betha, but not too terrible. Let's see. Or you can put it on a bed or a couch. So this is kind of the situation with the towel roll. And the other thing I wanted to show is pillows. So we're going to be trying to do something where we hit the corner of the pillowcase like this with our bachi. Like that. So it's useful to have a pillow set up like, see, I don't even know if this is gonna work with my chair. That's why I wanted to get together a few minutes early so that we could get this worked out. But like, so if I do this, can I sort of pretend that this is an anime stand? Go, right, like something like that. So that's kind of the idea here. Now, if you miss by too much, you'll whack the pillow off the chair. That's no fun. I know people have different like memory foam pillows and other pillows that wouldn't do the same thing, but basically like a pillowcase stuffed with clothes or a cloth shopping bag stuffed with clothes, that could also do really well. So that like the idea is to have a corner so that you have a defined spot. The other thing about the blanket or towel roll up that I wanted to talk about is that, so can everybody see like the terry cloth fabric of the towel? So the cool thing here, and I think I mentioned this in the message, is that if I hit it, you can actually see a light mark of exactly where I hit. And it's that way, what we're going to be doing with that is trying to hit the same spot, which Taiko are beautiful and everything, but it's bad when you leave a mark. Whereas in this towel, you just go like this and then it's fresh and you can do it again. So that's why I'm recommending that even if you do have Taiko, and I see some beautiful Shima Daiko that Aaron and Chu Daiko and stuff that Aaron has set up, but there's some value to actually like getting out a piece of fabric that you can see where you poked into the fabric on. That's kind of the idea there. Is there anyone here who, hi Susan, very nice to meet you. Mila, wow, yay, hello people. do people have setup questions? So we'll go through setup stuff again, probably in like at say 58, just to get some of the people who are not here yet. Does anybody not have bachi? I know at least some people may not have bachi, and so like I said in the email, chopsticks work pretty well. A decent amount of the workshop, it's fine to use your hands, but obviously you can't toss your hands, that's not a thing. So there will be moments where having bachi will be helpful. So, okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I have a slant stand. Would that be helpful to bring in to put the towel on, or am I better to use a chair like you're doing?
I think it's pretty reasonable. In fact, I'm going to actually set up a slant stand with the drum on it right now. It'll be for demonstration purposes. But yeah, I mean, if you do have a taiko, like putting the rolled up towel on top of that will make it be like the right height, you know, versus like the bed or a chair is like, it's a little low for a betta stand, at least, you know, maybe if I were a kid or something, it would be more comfortable. But yeah, so feel free to like, you know, either take your stands or just put them, you know, I mean, like most people are okay putting towels on their taiko drums, right? Like usually a towel is used as a protective thing anyway, right? So feel free to do that. So I'm going to actually take a moment real quick. We have 5 more minutes. Hopefully people will start filtering in. And I'm going to take a moment to set up a slant stand, actually. So if you have a couch or something like that to set up on, that's a little bit better. Oh, I just remembered I need to pop something open. Hello. Just wanted to check in on people with their equipment setups, as it were. So The idea is to roll together, roll up a towel or two like this. You just fold it in half so that it's really long, then roll it up. The towels don't have to be clean, but it's ideal if they're dry. And I would put it, you can put it on a chair like I've done here. So the thing is, if you hit it while it's on a chair, this chair is pretty good actually, but sometimes the whole chair will shake. Whereas, so if you put it on a bed or a couch, it might not shake as much, and that might be nice. And then the other thing that I wanted to check that people have is a pillow with like a corner on it that you could like sort of prop up either on a chair or on a bed with more pillows, and that you could like hit a corner and the whole thing won't fall over. Anyone have any equipment setup concerns? Okay. Hello, hello, welcome. Okay, let's see. So some other logistical things. For those who haven't used Zoom before, you can pin my screen. So you can be in speaker view, but whether you're in speaker view or gallery view, which are the little controls up at the top right, it's really helpful if you hover with your mouse over my screen. It says mute, and then it says dot dot dot. And if you click on the dot, 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 it says pin video in the drop-down menu. And so you all should select pin video. I'm gonna be trying to look at all of you more often, but the reason to do this is that in case somebody is not muted and say like a dog barks in their background, all of a sudden Zoom will think that they're trying to talk and will give them the focus. And then if I don't say something loud enough right after that, then all of a sudden you won't be able to see me. So it's annoying. So at some point I might try muting you all, but for now, cool. Okay, well, it's 3 p.m. So I just wanted to start off by welcoming everyone. Thank you so much for coming. I know a few more people will be filtering in, but hopefully we'll be able to sort of welcome them as they come. So welcome to the first in the series of Computational Cognitive Neuroscience of Taiko practice. And today's topic, as I said, will be feedback systems. And so I have a main takeaway from this workshop, and I'm just going to tell it to you several times. And then the hope is that you'll see how the exercises that we do today and the resources that we talk about can relate to that and can be helpful to you in your practice, whether that's in the studio with beautiful Taiko to play with, or whether you're at home just working on your lap, or whatever the practice circumstance may be. And I know right now for most of us, the drum is going to be the rare case. So a lot of the workshop today is geared, in fact, I only have a drum here for demonstration. Like, we're not going to really use the drum. Okay, so, this workshop is intended as a 6-part series, and I will, today has a lot of overview components to sort of get you the flavor of how this is going to work. I will say before, I'll tell you more about the overall series later, but just to get people a sense of what's going on with the theme today and with what we're working on in the first few segments, the idea is that that we have drills that we can do for practice, and there are things that we can do to use these drills better. You know, you may have heard some people say study less, remember more. So some of this, you know, today we're not talking about memory so much, that'll be like workshop 3. But the point is that I think when a lot of us think about drills and practice, we think about something where, you know, we have a lot of, you know, there's a lot of focus, and that's really important. But basically, like, I don't know, I think that there's a sense in which we could sort of demystify what practice really is and sort of simplify it in a way so that we can work on good drill design or take the drills we have and use them to the best of our ability so that it really promotes our learning. Okay, so today the takeaway from feedback systems is basically that your body, your brain especially, is the controller in a giant feedback system involving your outputs, your arms in this case, or other parts of your body that you're performing with. And so the goal here is to show you how to use drills to engineer fast and automatic learning and skill development. A lot of the basics that we do in a sort of standard Taiko practice already does this. It already sets us up for good things in that way, which is good, right? That's how we get started as, you know, as being good Taiko players. And so this is just to help really deepen that and help us understand, like help us dig into like, well, why do we do these drills? And what about doing these drills, or what about even just making it to Taiko practice every week or every however many days, is really going to help us become better Taiko players. Okay, so I would like us to get started. So first, let us make some room. We're going to need enough room to sort of wave our arms around quite a bit. So I'm gonna actually push this back. All right, we're gonna start with the warm-up. So part of the purpose of this warm-up is going to be to work on isolating parts of our body. This has to do, I think, with building good mental representations and also just training our body to move sort of the parts that we wanna be able to move independently or to move them under a certain kind of control. I mean, if you think about it, like our hands, we would think like, yes, I know how to use my hands. But when we come to Taiko practice, arguably, we're learning how to use our hands in a different way from how we would use it, say, to eat, right? So, so it can be helpful to sort of do these isolation exercises. I'm going to be pulling these from a variety of dance styles. I'm going to turn on some music, and I want you all to let me know, that you can hear the music, and that you can hear me talking over it. Relaxed, dreamlike state. Can people hear this music? Yes. Great. And can you hear my instructions? So if I were here telling you to do things, audible, please make a big X sign if there's a problem. Okay. I'm going to stay on gallery view so that I can keep checking in on you. Okay. I'm going to turn it down a little bit. All right. Cool. So we're going to just shake it out real quick. Right. We're going to start with our heads. We're going to start by looking side to side. 5, 6, 7, 8. Look, center, look, center. Look, center, look. No center. Look, 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 look. Down, center, up, center, down, center. No center. Down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Tilt, center, tilt, center, tilt, center, tilt. No center. Tilt, 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 tilt. Roll. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Again, roll. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Other way. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Again. 2, 3, 4, 5. Shoulders up and down. Up and down. Faster. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Isolate. Up and down. Up and down. Faster. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Other side. Up and down. Up and down. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. Everyone turn to the side like this. I'm gonna have us move our shoulders forward and backward like this. Notice I want my head and the rest of my body to stay in a straight line, okay? So when I put my shoulders forward, I don't want to like throw the rest of my body back or slouch or something like that. When I put it back, I don't want to push my chest out. I just want to put my shoulders back. Make sense? 5, 6, 5, 6, 7, 8. Forward, center, back, center, forward, center, back, center, forward, back, forward, back, forward, back, forward, back. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Other way. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Roll, 2, 3, 4. Roll, 2, 3, 4. So you can do these kinds of isolation exercises. We've done head and shoulders. You can do the hips. We're gonna skip that for now, and we'll come back here. You can also do hips. So now for hips, I'm gonna lower the camera so you can see me well. So when I move my hips, we're gonna do side to side first. When I go side to side, it's the best thing. Okay. I'm gonna try to move my hips without moving like my whole shoulders and head and the rest of the thing. Keep your knees loose. It's okay to bend your knees. side to side first. 5, 6, 5, 6, 7, 8, side, center, side, center, side, center. No center, side, 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 side. Sorry, perhaps I need to work on my isolations more. All right, front and back. So everybody turn to the side. So for front and back, again, keep your knees loose, it's okay to bend them. But try to keep everything above this, above your hips, still. You maybe feel this as sort of like a pelvic tilt. That's okay too. 5, 6, 7, 8, forward, center, back, center, forward, center, back, no center, forward, back, forward, back, forward, back, forward, back. Roll, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, again. Roll, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, other way. Roll, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, again. Roll, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Cool. All right, now I want everyone to make a T-shape. Yeah, my legs are not very important right now. Make a T-shape. Now you're gonna pretend that you have teacups all along your arm full of tea. And so if you tilt them, the tea will fall out. If your arms get kind of loosey-goosey, the tea will fall out. If you stop paying attention to your hands and let them fall, the teacups at the bottom will fall out. So it's not good, right? All right, so the rule is don't spill the tea, keep the tea up, okay? Now take one leg, either leg, and step out pretty wide. So just to show you my legs a little bit, step out pretty wide. We're gonna reach to the side, and again, don't spill the tea, none of this. I wanna see straight, keep this totally flat. 5, 6, 5, 6, 7, 8. Reach and reach and reach and reach. Reach. And both sides. Notice these pretty arms. Pay attention to both arms. Make a nice curve with each of them. So don't do this. You see nice arms. 2, 5, 6, 7, 8. Reach, 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 reach. And other side. Pretty arms. I love everybody's arms. And bring it to center. Breathe and then stretch up to the top, leg straight. Exhale, bend your legs again. Come up to neutral and again. Stretch, stretch, stretch. Sorry, that's not an isolation exercise. It just feels good. Okay, all right. So we actually got our ribcage isolation in with this reach thing. So, okay. I'm going to turn off the music for a bit. Sorry. Okay. Great. Now I don't have to yell either. Okay. Hi, welcome to those who've joined us in the meantime. We're doing warm-ups. And what we just talked about is these isolation exercises that we're doing to try to help give our minds better control over moving the parts of our body and the systems of our body that are important for Taiko. So one thing I also really want to point out is if you think about the three sets of exercises that we did, so well, there's head, but then there's shoulders, rib cage, and the hips. I know sometimes in Taiko workshops that I've taken, say with folks like PJ Hidabayashi, she'll mention that you should think of these as a rectangle, right? And the idea is to keep the rectangle together. So even if you're twisting, that just keeping these stacked up. So obviously this kind of a movement does not keep them stacked up, but it's really different from this, which sort of warps the rectangle. So there's sort of different like physical logics to how you can do this. But the point is like, these are to help us gain awareness of our bodily rectangles so that hopefully we can have the awareness for them and it's not other people who have to tell us when we're in our stance, like, hey, your hips are like way out here, come on, like make them center and things like that. The other thing is with forward back, I notice a lot of times that people play like this, especially if there's a drill with a lot of like where I need to reach and hit katas and stuff, people will sort of pull their shoulders all the way out. And just, it's important to understand where center is. So this is too far forward. This is too far back. Most people don't have this problem, but usually when I say like, hey, your shoulders are really far forward, push them back. People will do this sometimes. And I'm like, come on, no, here's center, know where center is. So part of the point of doing this is to really teach us where center is. Okay, so one more warm-up-y type thing that I want to do, but which really starts to get us into the idea of feedback systems. So what we're going to do is, I want you to see my feet right now. Everyone see my feet? Cool. No, let's see. Yes, you can see my feet now, right? Okay, so stand on one leg. With the other leg, I'm going to turn to the side. So we're going to go point and flex, point and flex. And I just want to clarify. So let's see. This is not pointing my foot. Even this is not pointing my foot. You see how my toes are all scrunched up? That's not good. The toes, when we say point your toes, technically you're not pointing your toes. You're actually just like making this straight. That's what pointing your toes is. It's not really about like, yeah, you can leave these pretty loose and that's pretty fine. So don't, this will start to hurt eventually. Okay. Yeah, it's like if I were here, it's just doing that. That's all. Okay. 5, 6, 7, 8, point and flex, point and flex, point and flex, point and other foot, point and flex, point and flex, point and flex, point and flex. Okay, so one cool thing about what we just did there is that we balanced on one leg. I don't know, these are the sorts of things that we sort of take for granted every day. But if you think about it, how did you balance on one leg? So what was it that allowed you to do that? So the next exercise that we're gonna do is slightly dangerous. It is not the OMG dangerous thing, but it is slightly dangerous. If you would like, feel free to have something to stabilize yourself with, because we're gonna be doing some balance stuff for the next few minutes. Or just make sure there's nothing that could like fall and hurt you or anyone else. Okay, so let's go back to that position with our leg up. I guess, I don't know, I'll keep this on my leg. It sort of doesn't matter what I'm pointed at. Okay, now what I want you to do is, I want you to, yeah, okay, I'm gonna make this point in my upper body again. Okay, sorry. Just turn around and wave to somebody over your shoulder. Turn around and wave to someone over your other shoulder. So this is like a little bit harder balancing work, right? Okay, so now what I want us to do is just get in this neutral position, shoulders centered and everything. Just close your eyes and try to keep your balance. I'm going to open my eyes and watch you all, but okay. Cool. So keep trying this. Feel free to switch to the other foot as I'm talking, but I'm just going to tell you some things as you continue trying to do this. When you're falling over, as will happen if you're not used to this, try not to fall sideways. I see quite a few people falling sideways. My suggestion is, when you're in danger of falling over, lower your foot so that your toes then touch the ground. So I guess open your eyes and look at my camera for a minute. So my foot's on the ground, and I'm gonna raise it, and I'm gonna close my eyes. And if I'm in danger of falling, I'm gonna put my foot down like this. And then when I feel okay again, I'm gonna lift my leg. So feel free to try that on both feet. For people who are like doing really great at this and having absolutely no problem, you can also try this. Oops, need to show my feet. You can also try this just starting from, in ballet we call this first position, or really just have your feet sort of together and try this going up on the balls of your toes. Try closing your eyes. And I want you to feel which muscles are shaking or which muscles are working really hard. And I want you to feel how fast they're working compared to when your eyes are open. So once you sort of stabilize, it's the same muscles, right? But they're not working nearly so fast, right? Okay, everybody stop. You can stop trying to balance now. Okay, so what I want to, what I'm hoping that people will get out of this is the realization that, so we have a variety of different sensory streams. So if we think about what is the process that allowed us to balance. So in general, you would think, so we, it turns out that we have little rocks in our ears, and there's a few of them, and they help us keep track of balance and sort of where you're pointing, like how you're tilted in three dimensions. The technical term for them and so on is not all that important. What I want you to realize is that yes, technically you use those for balance, but I hope it's really abundantly clear that you use vision for balance as well. And that as soon as I took away, or well, you took vision away from yourself by closing your eyes, all of a sudden, your body had to compute different things. Your body had to, like, the feedback loops in your body that help you know where you are in space and try to adjust to make you stand up straight, something different had to happen, right? Okay. And the reason that I wanted you to feel this is that you could feel that the muscles in your feet had to, like they really had to adjust a lot faster, right? So this tells me another thing. It tells me that the information that I'm getting from my visual system is faster than the information that's coming from from not my visual system. And there's actually several things. So there's the like 3D autolith based thing in your ear. But also your feet, they're pressing against the ground, and the more points of contact you have with the ground, like, so, you know, literally your feet has touch sensors in it, right? And so you can absolutely use the touch sensors in your feet to stabilize, right? So you're already using two sensory modalities. And it's still the case that vision is so fast. We are so used to balancing using our visual system, and the information is just so good that it really lets our feet relax while we're balancing. And of course, everyday activities like walking and running and so on do use this kind of balance in sort of a dynamic situation. If you think about it, our Taiko stance, well, so there's several Taiko stances we can take, right? So for many, many groups, say if we're going to play Beta or Naname, we might take a stance like this. What's the first thing we say? Make an imaginary rectangle with your feet, right? So a huge imaginary rectangle like this is pretty stable. So stability is something we talk about in feedback systems too. But yeah, so basically, like, having this huge footprint really helps stabilize you, right? But one thing I want you to think about is there a direction that someone could push me in my sort of standard Betha playing Taiko stance that I'm more likely to fall forward or backward, or to fall over, I should say. I don't want to be leading. So there might be slight differences if someone pushed me head on versus if they pushed me from the side. There might be slight differences. It might have to do with the kind of rectangle I'm making with my foot. But one thing is, so if this is the axis that my feet are on, if somebody pushes me perpendicular to that axis, it's a lot harder for me to withstand that. Or I have to think about how to use my feet and use my body to push in a direction, say forward or something like that, where I have some connection with the ground and I'm not gonna get pushed over. So, you know, if I'm doing something like Yodan and now I am flat to the drum, I don't know if this has happened to a lot of people, but like sometimes I will just fall over backwards because I was too into what I was doing. And then finally, if you think about the kind of feet together stances that we use for Hachijo Daiko when we're wearing closed hapi, closed yukata, that like you can almost think of this as like now I have one point of contact with the ground, but really what's happening is I have a very, very tiny rectangle. It's like toes number one, toes number two, right? So hopefully thinking about balance this way will be helpful. Okay. Before we move on to the next piece of this, I want to talk about how to take notes. So if you have pen and paper, this would be a good moment to go get it, or pencil and paper. So I know a lot of people are used to taking notes on their computers. That's really popular these days. And I want to tell you that there's a study that says that this is not a good idea. And the study was done by a friend of mine, so that's why I trust it. Just kidding. I've also read the paper, and I will be sending you all after this workshop a link to the original paper and a popular news media article, like on the radio kind of article about it so that you can read these for yourself and see if you're convinced. But the basic, and the method is very cool. It's a very readable paper. I encourage you to take it, to skim it. But the overall upshot that I want to tell people about how to take notes on Taiko or anything else, but you know, for now we're talking about Taiko, is that it's important to take them by hand on a piece of paper like this, my terrible handwriting. And so part of the reason is that what the researchers found is that when people take notes using their computer, it's almost like they're like a secretary in a meeting trying to take the minutes. It's almost like they're trying to type everything, because you can actually write, you can type so much faster than you usually do when you're writing longhand, that people tend to try to write down too much. And then what ends up happening is they're effectively just stream processing. It's like came in the ear, went out the fingers, and it's just, it's almost like you're trying to use, you know, your notepad app as like an external brain or something. But here's the thing. What's really important in a learning environment is that you actually process the material that you're learning. And for all of you who know this already, and I know many of you are educators and so on, please bear with me, but I just think it's important to say this as often as we can, that notes are very personal. So when you're taking notes today, please try not to make notes that if you just gave them to someone else in your Taiko group, that like they could just read it and it was almost as if they had come to the workshop themselves. Like, no, don't try to document the whole thing. We are recording this. They could just watch the videos themselves and follow along later. Instead, please try to take notes that are really personally meaningful to you and that really, that have more to do with sort of your understanding. Write down questions that you have that pop into your mind. At any point in time, like, please feel free to just pause whatever the exercise is and go write down a note. That's totally fine, especially since we're all in our homes and it's not like disruptive in a studio in any way. So we can take advantage of that. Any questions? I know everybody's muted right now, but feel free to unmute yourself if you have any questions or comments about that. Okay. Any questions or comments about some of the stuff we've talked about so far? Okay, all right. So I'm gonna spend, great. I'm gonna spend a few minutes delivering some sort of technical material on feedback systems that I want to be sort of the basis of what's important for today. And then we're going to do a bunch of exercises that sort of feature those and let you explore those. All right. So we've looked at a feedback system, our balance system already. We use that one every day. But to think about mathematically or from an electrical engineering perspective, what we need for a feedback system, I'd say a system is just like a box that does something. It could be our brain and our body or something like that. And you need an input and you need an output. So in this case, the input may be, say the ability to see the visual system, right? Like when we could see the rest of the room that helped our bodies stabilize, then what's the output? The output is your performance or sort of the output of your muscles or your body in some way. So you could take, for instance, like how much you were falling over or whether you felt stable or something like that as an output signal. So these are signals. And the different sensory modalities, different technologies, say like a camera. So right now we don't have, like we can't see ourselves with our own eyes, not easily. But with the webcam or with the mirror, all of a sudden we have this ability to see our whole bodies, and this that gives us that can provide us a very rich input signal, right? And if you think about the difference between a mirror and a camera, in a mirror, well, you only get to see one side of yourself, but also it's immediate, it's instantaneous, right? Whereas with a camera or a webcam, usually there's some amount of delay. It could be short, or it could be that someone is taking a video of you and in 3 days they'll upload the video. You still get the feedback, but there's like 3 days worth of lag in there, right? So it can be sort of harder to correct problems right at the moment that that happens. So I want you to, as we're talking about signals and systems, as we were thinking about, well, the visual system, that was pretty fast in this case, I want you to think about the time course of the different kinds of signals we can be paying attention to. Sort of that's really crucial for how we're going to form good feedback systems. So we have an input and an output. Now, part of what's going to happen is, let's say, we know what we want with the input, right? Like, we want to be stable. We want to not be falling over, okay? So that's sort of, that's the desired, right? Now, I have some visual input of, you know, the world on my eyes, the world on my retina. And if that changes too much, if that's sort of starting to tilt, then I know I'm falling over or something like that, perhaps, right? So basically what I can do is I can take like, okay, if I'm stable, then the world will be stable on my eyes, versus if the world starts to change a lot, that means that I'm probably falling, right? So what I'm doing in that is I'm comparing the desired versus the output, right? Which then becomes the input. So what we're doing with the feedback system is we're taking the difference of what we want versus what we got, okay? That minus sign is really crucial. This is called negative feedback. There's a lot of ways that people use feedback in different fields, but feedback in this situation, negative feedback is what we want. Negative feedback is very good. It doesn't mean someone is like, you're terrible, and like whipping you or something. Like, negative feedback is not, it's not always awful. But in this case, I guess you can think of it as bad in the sense that when you compare, what happens is your brain is producing an error signal. And basically saying, how much error do I have compared to what I wanted? Now, if the way that your drill or your system or your learning environment is set up is to try to drive the error signal to zero, right? Any kind of error is like not good, right? But if we can make that error as small as possible, then we're getting closer to what we want, right? So a lot of the stuff that we're gonna be doing today is all about making sure that you have a really good high fidelity source of an error signal, and that you use the error signal in a way to improve your training. So that you specifically are trying to make that error signal, push that down to zero, or push it down as small as you can. All right, so this brings us to our first drill. All right, so I'm going to grab my towel roll. Ah, yes, towel roll. Does anyone need help making a towel roll? I don't remember who was here and who wasn't. Can you please unmute yourself and let me know if you need help making a towel roll? It's basically like take a blanket or towel and fold it in half and then roll it up and then put it on something. Great, okay. All right, so I'm gonna turn so you can see it. All right, so you can put this on top of your Taiko, or even just put, just let me know if it's falling, you know, we can talk this out. I know in coronavirus times, life is very strange. But basically, we're just going to take some simple hits, just go don, 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 don. And you can mirror me, though we're from the side, so that's probably not a huge deal right now. But I believe I have my camera mirrored. So for instance, this is my right hand, and this is my left hand. Yeah, this is my right hand. Okay, not that it super matters, but just mirror me. So we're gonna take four hits. So first, just rub your bachi over your, like make a nice clean slate. Then we're gonna do four hits, just simple elbow hits. So, re, don, 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 don. Okay, now everybody look at your towel. So here's mine. I think I hit about at least two places. Like, you can even see the little bachi track. You can see it trying to meet in the middle, but it's actually kind of, there was a hit there. Yeah. So I hit like two spots. I think I hit three times there and one time there. So what's cool is I can actually just measure, this is my error. This is it. This is my motor error. Okay. So now what we can do is, so let's try that a few more times. And what I want you to do, slow it down, take it at your own pace. Try to make, you know, maybe even hit smaller, hit from closer to the drum. Don, 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 don. Hopefully that's easier to make the error go to zero, right? So part of what's happening here is that we're realizing that in the systems of our bodies, that there are several factors that we can do that increase this motor error. So I could hit faster, but still from pretty close. I could go dot 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 dot. Okay, that was eight, but you know what I mean. And now I'm like, ah, okay, now my error is back to this, right? Because I went too fast. Or I can go back to hitting slowly, and I can take it. I can hit from further away. So I'm going to do a full arm strike now. Don, 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 don. My error is a little bit bigger than it was when I was doing elbow hits. So if you think about it, it's almost like there's like a distribution, a bell curve, you know? And so on average, most of your hits will probably fall in the center of your bell curve, but then it's like, it's all like falling off to the sides. So, you know, with some probability, you'll hit pretty far away, but you'll probably hit fairly close. You know, they'll be like mostly clustered like this, right? So the idea is to tighten up the distribution of your hits, ideally to just where you want to hit. And in order for that to happen, it's really useful to be able to see where you're hitting. So you can, in real time, like when you're hitting a real drum, you can look where you're hitting. What are other things we can do to figure out if we're hitting the exact same place? I know one thing that people say is try to make your left and right hand sound the same. So you can try to use the tone, the sound of the hit, to try to make sure that your precision, that your motor control is very good. But if you think about it, it might be the case, because our brains are very, very, very smart, that if what you use, remember we said inputs and outputs, and then the feedback, right? If I use sound as a feedback, what if my right hand is so smart that it has figured out, well, via my brain, how to hit in a way to mimic how the left hand sounds, even though they're using two totally different techniques. Yeah. So this is basically what this means, is that if I'm using that auditory signal, so I can use two totally different techniques to make my hits sound the same. Is that the same as having like identical, like bimanual motor control? Nope, it's not. And with the visual system, I could visually make it so that I hit exactly the same, and then try to hit the exact same point, right? So these are all kinds of feedback control that I can do. These are all ways that with a simple 4-8-16-32 or simple doko doko drill, these are all the kinds of things that we can be thinking about in terms of taking our technique to the next level. And really, at the end of the day, I would say that we probably want to take a combination of all of this information. So it's basically like feedback loops on feedback loops. So just the same way that when we were balancing and we were able to use the information from our ears and from the balls of our feet and from our visual system, all of these sensory modalities, all of these input signals and sort of subsequent output signals of them, were being used to tell us whether we were doing a good job of balancing. We're being used to drive that error to zero. And taken together, perhaps we could do a better job. Now, there's no way to do just one of those. So in other words, you can't use just your visual system and then not use like your touch and your vestibular system is what it's called, with the stones in your ears. Like, we can't remove that unless you happen to have one of the disorders where your vestibular system stops working. But yeah, we can at least take the vision away sometimes, and that can give us a sense of how the rest of the system is working. Okay. All right. Let's see. I want to talk about, while we're still talking about basics, I want to talk about another really important kind of feedback system, signal. I'm going to turn this around so I'm more comfortable. And that is pain and weirdness. So a lot of people tend to think with Taiko, no pain, no gain, or they tend to think, well, I'm weak, this is supposed to hurt. And I really want to fight back against that because I think it's actually causing a lot of people to have huge mistakes in their technique that they just let stay because it's almost like they think the pain means that they're doing it right. After prolonged Taiko study, like after several weeks of playing something, it probably shouldn't hurt. I am not a clinician, but what I'm saying is from the perspective of an engineer and from the perspective of someone with enough of a sense of physiology to understand, like to be able to say, hey, this is what pain is. Pain is basically your body telling you that like you're trying to go further than a joint wants to go, or that, you know, your muscles can't handle what you're doing right now. Blisters are another good, you know, like, hey, your something is rubbing, right? All of these different sources of pain, soreness, creakiness, and so on. You know, you may not notice the creakiness until the next day, but I think it's important to think about, does this mean that I could do something differently with my technique? And so if you have someone who you're studying Taiko with, I think thinking about pain really critically and also like weirdness, like if you're like doing something with your shoulder in order to do a hit, like please ask questions or, you know, get a second opinion from someone else in your group, or just try to think about your technique and really focus in on it instead of letting that continue, because like doing something weird with your shoulder, eventually you could have, you know, a rotator cuff injury or something like that. You know, you could be building up like repetitive strain injuries in your hands and so on. And so I think it's really, really important to think about pain. And so I wanted to really just bring up that pain and weirdness are important feedback signals. If we were in the studio, there's a like particular drill we could do where I think it would be good at showing us where that weirdness can lie. I'm going to show you what it is briefly so that when you next have access to a drum, or if you find a cool way to do this in your home, you can do it. But I don't want to take the time to try to do it now because I couldn't think of sort of a universal setup. So I'm going to move this drum closer to us. Nope, I'm not. I'm going to move the computer closer to the drum because that's nicer to my drum stand. Okay. So there's a few different variations of this drill, but the kuchishoga for this, and it's a really common drill. Thank you to everyone who taught me this drill. But it goes, sore, kara doko, pang pang doko is one line of it. So if we go, kara doko, pang pang doko, kara doko, pang pang doko. I see some people drumming along on their laps at home. That's great. So, with each of these different kinds of hits, I might feel like as I'm having to move my arms and move my body in different ways, I might find like some sort of a catching point or pain or weirdness or something, especially with those pangs. So in case anyone hasn't run into pangs with a piece like Jack Bazaar or something before. So, oops, sorry. I have no idea if that sound was remotely faithful. Oh. That sound might have also gotten filtered out. Did it get filtered out? Yeah. Okay. I'm not going to do too much of this, so I'm not going to bother to go change the setting. But yeah, sorry. I should have fixed that in settings beforehand. I apologize. Okay. Things to know for next time. Okay. So the point is, I'm just going to do it a couple times. And especially on the pangs, the point is to think about where pain and weirdness might be coming into it. Sore, kara, and so on. Okay. So now the thing about this drill is that you can use the visual system, you can use how the bachi is snapping back in your hands. So for instance, with the pens, it's this really like sharp feeling in my hands. It feels different from a ka. It feels different from a doko or like a dege kind of situation. So this is really just to point out that, you know, we can use our hearing. We can use how it feels in our hands, which I think is really underrated in Taiko. Like thinking about how a hit feels is something that I would just really like to promote more. And we can also use the visual of literally, can we do this drill? And so on. Okay. And thinking about pain and weirdness and using that to generate questions. So for instance, let's say, Yuta taught me this drill, which is a true fact, he did. So I could say, hey Yuta, like, I'm running into trouble on the pangs on my left hand. It feels a little weird, like I feel tingles right there or something like that. And you know, then we can talk about, oh, is that a nerve tingle or is that, you know, the skin getting smacked of a tingle and so on. So please ask questions based on pain and weirdness. Because I think we could all play better taiko if we asked each other more questions, I think. Okay, all right. Now I would like to transition over to a pillow.
All right.
I'm gonna have this set up on this chair for now. This should be fine. So we already did this drill where we did what's called position control, trying to hit the exact same spot, right? Right. So here, this is the tip of my pillow, and I'm going to be using this as the spot that I really want to hit. Right now, I want to pretend that the tip of my pillow, that it's this spot on the drum right here. So we're going to do four beats out of the oh so popular piece Jack Bazaar. And the way that it goes is like this. I will demonstrate it on the pillow. So it is. You're hitting kas, and each of these hits is the same point. It's always this point here. So you're gonna go ga, da, da, ga. So left, right, right, left. I'll sing the kuchi shoga for everyone a few times and sort of airbachi it in a really small way so that it all fits into the frame. Here's the point. Ichi, ni, sore, left, right, right, left. Sore, left, right, right, left. Okay, my little point is falling. There we go. Yeah. All right, so please stop me if you have any questions with that, but I just want people to try this ga, da, da, ga. Yeah, left, right, right, left. And so the reason that I want people to try this is, remember one thing we worked on before is that if I really want to hit a particular point like this, one way that I can do it is by hitting from not so far away, right? You can go, ga, da, da, ga. It's really nice and small, and I know I'm gonna hit the same point, right? So this is, the point is to try to hit that very tip and like not squish it, right? We're trying to hit very precisely. You know, before when we were just hitting like a betta, a chudaiko, when we were hitting the center of the drum, you know, if you hit a little bit far off, it's not a big deal. It's still a hit. The audience knows you hit the drum. But in Jack Bazaar, for lines like this, one thing that I find is in order to have really good, like huge arms where my arms like coming out of nowhere, whoosh, whoosh, that when I try to do those hits, sometimes I miss. I'm looking at the drum. I'm trying to hit the drum. I do not hit the drum. Why? Position control, motor error. It's because what's happening is, remember how I said there's a distribution of where you hit? Well, there's a distribution around this point in space. There's like a ball in space. So it's very dense at the center. And then with some probability, it spreads out in space like this. So with some probability, with a low probability, I'll hit here, this point in space, at the edge of my fingertip. With a higher probability, I'll hit here or here. Now, as long as I hit a position that actually results in connecting with the drum, it seems fine, right? Of course, then there's also the point on my stick that I hit with. Like, you know, sometimes we tell people, okay, a good ka, unless it's a piece where we have lighter and darker ka's, like different sounds where we're intentionally hitting here. But we usually say like, okay, try to hit with the top inch of the bati. And that's hard, right? Sometimes people try to play katas and stuff and they miss, right? So the point is like, you know, when I see folks with, you know, lots of dents in the middle of their bati, and like, I know that they're hitting katas like this. And it's like, why, right? We want you to develop the motor control to be able to hit it with the tip of your bati. Does that make sense? So when we're doing drills like kara doko, pang pang doko, this is another thing that we can pay attention to, is that, you know, when you're practicing on your own, to actually slow it down so that you really are hitting the tip, okay? So coming back to this drill, I want people to really try. I'm gonna turn this again. So really this hand doesn't matter. This is mostly this hand that matters, right? But like coming from as far away as you can, whoosh, like actually hit. Oh, see, I keep missing. There we go, I hit it, right? And then for each of these situations, if you just barely hit it, and then a lot of the times miss, then it's like your point cloud, your distribution of where you're hitting, it's too far up. What you want to actually aim for is to make your point cloud be centered on the point that you want to hit. So try to make it so that with equal probability, you miss by a little bit, and with equal probability, you hit too far down, okay? Because otherwise you're training yourself to mostly miss, and that's not good. Because then, like, it's just everybody else is going to be playing those hits and you're not playing them. So try to, like, make sure that your distribution is centered in the right place. Don't center it, like, don't be like, ah, okay, well, I don't want to hit too far down, and so I'm going to always err on the side of being in the air. Don't do that. So, and in the same way, if you never miss, and, okay, maybe this is actually a pretty big insight. When you're playing that line of Jack Bazaar or a similar line, if you never miss, then you're not being precise enough either, because that means that the center of your distribution is not the exact point you wanted it to be. It's lower than that. And that's why, it's more likely that that's why, say, 95% of the time you're able to do the hit. Now, when we're practicing, we want to actually 50% of the time miss, or not 50, I'm sorry. We want most of the time, whatever the exact distribution is, we want most of the time to hit the exact point we want. And then with equal probability, like half of the rest of the bad hits, right? So for the not good enough hits, we want half of them to be misses, and we want half of them to be too far down. Does that make sense? Cool. All right. I would like us to take a quick water break. Feel free to bang around on this. And I'm also gonna, let me see, I think I can unmute everybody. Please feel free to like shout out questions. Yeah. And Dan, I'm gonna mute you. Okay, you muted yourself.
Yeah, this is all inner game. So it's the same. But you should make a comment.
We're unmuted.
Yeah, everybody's unmuted. I'm really sorry. I should have said that louder. You're all unmuted right now. Because it's a water break, and I'd love to hear comments or questions that you have. Now is a great time for that.
Glad to see everybody. Yay, cool.
Wait, so Sassen, the 50-50 you're talking about.
Yeah, that's.
We want to make the ideal hit most of the time, but when we don't, that's where the 50-50 comes in.
That's right. It's 50% of the failures that should be in each direction. Yeah. So, and if you do that, then it should still be the case that most of the hits are the desired point. Yeah.
And what is most mean, like more than 50% or 90%, you know?
Let me see if I can whiteboard. This sounds like a good moment to try whiteboarding. Okay. So if this is position, P for position, and this is, I'm gonna mark this as 0. Wow, this is great. Okay. So 0 is the desired position. So like star, that's where we want to hit, right? So basically, like, there's gonna be some, that's not great. But there's gonna be some distribution, right? So, right, actually, this is maybe what most people look like when they're playing katas, right? The center and sort of the, probably where the mean is, given that I drew this bimodal distribution, or this unimodal distribution like this, that, like, here's where we really wanted to hit. And if you hit down here, then see, look at, like, if you look at the area here, right? This is much larger than that. So if I hit on this side, then this is air. And I missed it. Okay. Ooh, cannot write. But yeah. So this is air, and then this is you hit the rim in some way. So what we want to be doing is we want to center the distribution here. So I'm gonna draw the distribution first. Sorry, this is terrible, whatever. 0, there we go. Something like that. But as you can see from my crappy drawings, that honestly, like, your motor system could have all sorts of shapes of its distribution. It could have some awful wiggly thing of like, ooh. The only way that most of it hits, if as long as you're really centering, like, so if this is the 0 point, in this case, if this dip were low enough, that would be the only way that most of the hits were not, or like that, you know, that on average your hits were not on 0. Does that answer your question? Does that help you visualize the situation? Like, yeah. Right, so if this whole curve were flatter, gosh, we talk about flattening the curve means something totally different now, right? But if it's like this and this is 0, like, okay, this is like newbie taiko player. This is like taiko player who's done a few performances and like knows that they'd rather hit the drum than not. And so they're kind of like cheating it a little bit. Uh-huh. And then like, hopefully like better taiko players this one. And then like, so what's the ideal? Okay, if here's our 0, right? Our ideal is, woo, wow. Gosh, I cannot draw with this. That's not a loop. No. Talking about motor error. Okay, you get the point. That's a distribution, okay? I'm claiming that's a distribution. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Other questions? This is great. How do I go back to the whole stop share? Stop share. Great. More questions? Okay. Seems like most people have muted themselves again. There are issues with muting, I might try. Oh, wait, no. Well, we haven't. So I'm not in focus. How do I? Okay. I don't know if me pinning the video works for everyone else, but okay. All right. I want to do another drill that, actually, I want to give us another way that position control is important using the drill that we've already talked about, the ka ka doko, pang pang doko. So, is everybody back from water break? Oh gosh. That's a useless question to ask, isn't it? I'm sorry. I'm still getting used to this. Okay. Hopefully people are back. Okay. So when I'm playing these ka, do, ko, pang, pang, I'm not going to do it loud just so that it doesn't cut out the sound. But this is also a moment where you can use position control. So in the same way that when we were doing the Jack Bazaar, ga, 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 I missed one, but you get what I mean. In the same way that we were trying to hit the exact top of the drum, when I'm doing a drill like this, and this drill doesn't have to be done on anime, it can be done on Betha. But it's important to decide on an exact angle, like exact places that I want to hit. And then the way that I was drawing those distributions before, you can almost imagine, like, if this is the point I want to hit, then there's going to be like a little hill, a distribution of points that I actually hit, right? For each of these, there'll be a little distribution of points that I actually hit. And the goal is over time, as we do this drill, to tighten and tighten that distribution. And so, yeah. Now, this gets more exciting when we're moving, you know, obviously when we have huge movements, like with our arms. And it's also really important to think about when we're spinning around. So Jack Bazar also has a line. It's at the very end. And the exact details of the hits of that line don't matter. So I'm not going to, teach it. But there's a decent amount of choreography that we do where we hit, spin, and then hit again. Let's, for the moment, just take the idea that I want to hit and then hit, sorry, that after my spin, I want to hit the center of my drum. So I'm not going to do this on the drum. I'm going to do this on our friend, the towel. So I'm going to use my pillow to prop up my towel like this. Whoops. So now my towel is kind of slanted. It's sort of maname now. Okay. Okay, I just don't want it to fall off the bed. So let's say if I'm playing naname, whatever, I'm doing this cool Jack Bazar piece. Okay, I really don't want to hit the camera. I need to be careful. But fine, so I do some hit and I want to spin around and hit, right? And ideally I want to hit the exact same, I want to hit the center of the drum. So with this towel, we can do spinning exercises and try to hit the exact center of the drum. Now, before we go and do these full spins, and I know there are quite a few people here, gosh, a lot of people here who have performed Jack Bazar beautifully. So maybe you don't need this, but I still think it's a really good example of how to, like maybe you can use it for teaching. And for those of you who haven't done it before, I still want to make sure that this is accessible to you. And so we're going to step through this very slowly if you haven't done much spinning with Taiko before. So step away from your drum setup because we're gonna just be kind of in the center of our room. Make sure there's enough space around you to not hit something. So I don't want to hit my drum, so I'm going to kind of move towards you all. And I'm going to point this at my legs again. Okay. So let's say that I want to spin on this leg. This is the leg that I want to spin on, okay? So what I want us to do is first try just coming up on it. So just have your weight on the balls of your feet a little bit. Because for all that we said about stability, if you think about it, if you're trying to spin, the fewer points of contact you have with the ground, the better. If you have too many points of contact, that's actually kind of painful. I see some people putting on socks. You're welcome to do that. Personally, I like spinning barefoot. But yeah, whatever works for you. So first, yeah, just come up so that you're reducing, basically you're removing, if this is my foot, then I'm trying to just get on the balls of my foot, so I'm removing all this other contact with the ground so that I can spin around this point or something like that, right? So, okay, so we can just come up on our foot. Like that. Right? And if this were ballet, we would do like a nice pique or something, but we don't have to do that for Jack Bazar or whatever. We just want to come up on our foot. Okay, now having done that, having gotten stable with that, let's say, so if I'm facing forward right now, I want to do 90 degrees of a turn. So instead of going from here, spinning all the way around and coming back, I want to just turn 45 degrees, so from here to here. So I'm going to come from here, turn here, and come down. I'm a ballet person. I make my arms like this. Let's see. If you want to do something like this with your bachi, or just something that won't hit everybody, like, you know, pick something. But the point is, if you go past 90, like if I go here, now I've gone, I don't know, maybe 60 degrees or something. That's not great. I want to actually be able to spin 90 when I want to spin 90. So from here, come up and then come down. You want to come up or come down in a controlled way. Try not to fall out of it, if you can avoid that. Once 45 is starting to feel okay and doable, do 90. So if I'm here, I want to end facing 180 degrees away. Oh my gosh, I've been seeing 45 and 90. I'm sorry. This is really 90 degrees. It's a right angle. Sorry, y'all. I meant, yeah, do a quarter of a turn, 90 degrees. Okay, the second one is to do half of a turn, 180 degrees, and come down with control. So in that turn, I almost overshot. I had to like squeeze my feet against the ground to stop myself. Ideally, what I want to get good at is what I'm using my feedback systems for right now is how do I have to launch myself off the ground in order to, like, what's the right amount of force to put in, and how do I stabilize myself in midair and then come down cleanly from that? So there, that was a little bit better. Okay, so for some folks, as the half turn is getting better, now try to do three quarters of a turn. If I start here, I want to go around this way and end there. Cool. Nice. Yay. Okay. And now that we have a good sense of what spinning and like coming down in a controlled way feels like, as opposed to just spinning and hoping, let's try to come a full 180, full circle. So think about like how much energy do I need to put into myself? How do I get the right rotational velocity so that I'm not overspinning? One thing that I notice is that when I overspin, I get dizzy. I feel like part of what's happening is that my eyes are trying to predict what they're going to see, but I'm wrong about how much I was going to spin, right? So it's like, this mismatch is causing problems to some extent. So you can try it with your other foot. You can also try it, so you can try it with your other foot in the same direction. You can try it with the same foot in the other direction. Cool, so this is just sort of a framework of just, you know, first coming up and then a quarter of a turn and then half of a turn. And then let's see, one, two, three quarters of a turn, and then a full turn. And so if you can do this without using your other foot on the ground as like a drag weight or something to kind of friction you into stopping, like the more you can actually do the turn that you wanted to do, I think the easier time you will have with taiko choreography that relies on spinning. Also, the more you can do this without having to use your arms to stop the spin somehow, like the more your center and your core are in control of the turn, and the more you have sort of done the right thing in advance in order to produce the turn that you wanted, just the more in control the whole thing will be. So what we're doing here is we're doing position control, just like when we were hitting with our bachi, except now we're doing position control of the angles of our bodies after a spin, right? And so whatever angle you land on, ideally, you want it to be on average the position you wanted to land on. So hopefully most of the time you'll be getting to the right position. And for the times that you fail in either direction, hopefully you undershoot an equal amount of the time that you overshoot. And that will help ensure that you actually are training yourself to turn to the right place instead of trying to train yourself to turn less or more or something like that. Okay. So now, with that in mind, let's now clear our towel title, clear the slate, and try doing spins and just hit. So you'll hit once, dong, you'll spin, and the goal is to hit the same point. And to then do our little finger measure of how big was the difference after I finished my spin. You can just hit with your right hand or just pick a hand and hit with it and it's fine. So I have a distance of this much with this spin. Clear the slate, do it again. Ooh, I had a bigger distance this time. Be careful, try not to get too dizzy doing this. Take breaks, look at other parts of the room. I really don't people want people to be dizzy for the rest of this workshop, so maybe do this no more than 4 more times because I really don't want everyone to be dizzy. And I know that this is not the same as spotting and we're not talking about spotting today, sorry. Okay, beautiful spins, yay. I kind of want to take a video of this. This is great. Everybody's pirouetting around. I love it. Whee! Whee! Okay, cool. Oh no. Whatever. That didn't work. Okay. Awesome. All right. All right. New reflector time. So I've sort of dropped hints of this a little bit along the way, but one thing that we've sort of snuck into this is the idea of mental representations. So this is something that there's a whole nother workshop on mental representations on, but it already comes up in talking about feedback systems. And so I wanted to start to clarify what that is and give us a way of using this time that we have at home during quarantine to improve our mental representations. So when we were hitting on the towel Taiko here, this is giving us like a two-dimensional position representation of where we hit. But if you think about it, really position is three dimensions, sort of X, Y, and Z, right? We have three axes that we could hit something or fail to hit it on. And that came up when we were hitting the pillow top, right? We really want to hit that point on the pillow. And that's a three-dimensional point. And so it turns out with mental representations that we have, you know, of the Taiko or of our hands and our bodies, like in some ways what we're trying to do is we're trying to make our representations of our bodies and like then using our muscles and our bodies to then do something. And so we're trying to like make these representations line up. And that's sort of, I guess that's what a hit is in this case. But yeah. So let's make this concrete. If you think about it, when you were first learning Taiko, let's say that somebody taught you Matsuri Daiko, so we have don, 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 kara, ka, ka, something like that, right? And you know, when you're new to Taiko, what this looks like, if you ask someone to airbachi, I'm gonna stand up. If you ask someone to airbachi Matsuri Daiko, like, and if they're new, they'll often do something like this. Don, 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 kara, ka, ka. Now, I don't know if you noticed, but all three of those dons were in wildly different places. One was here, one was here, and one was here. Like, really huge distance apart. And so one of the things that I do, that I think we are doing as we do airbachi, and the reason that I think that it is a productive thing to practice, is that I've noticed over time that particular stances that I have practiced a lot, I get better at imagining them. And that's what this mental representation is. So, you know, over time, we get to the point of being able to we get to the point of being able to have like a small part point in space that we're repeatedly hitting because we really believe that this is where the center of our Taiko is, right? So you know, I could say like, okay, why don't we just, why don't we all air bocce more? Why don't we try to improve our representations just by air bocceing? Well, the thing is, that doesn't produce an error signal because everything's imagined. How do you know if you got it right or not? So here's something that I've started doing, which I think really helps with that. Let's go, we can do this on the Taiko, and we can also do this on, a towel. But basically what we're going to do, let's do this on the towel for now, just so that it's not loud. What we're gonna do with the air bocceing is that, so as before with position control, when we're picking a particular point on the towel and saying that is the center of my drum and that's the point that I wanna hit. In addition to that, we're gonna say, actually, I wanna hit the point in space like a finger's width in front of it. I want to hit just a little bit in the air, okay? So I'm air bocceing, I'm not hitting, I guess right now you can't tell because like the towel is not very loud, but the point is to try to hit as close as I can to the desire, to the like real desired point, without actually hitting it. So if I do this on a Taiko, it's a lot more obvious when I miss in one direction, right? So now if I do this, if I say, okay, I want to hit a point like one finger's width in front of the real center of the drum, sometimes I'm going to get it wrong and I'm going to hit the drum and then that'll be loud, right? So, oops, right? So sometimes I'm going to just barely accidentally whack it, right? You can do this with, you know, your towel, something you feel safe with. You can do it, I don't know, you could do it with all sorts of things. You could do it with the floor. Yeah, options. So let's everyone take a moment. Whatever version of Matsuri Daiko your group plays, try to airbachi Matsuri Daiko. So you realize with this that you have to have a representation, not just of the center of the taiko, but the reason I chose Matsuri is that you also have to have a representation of the rim, the fuchi, right? Of where you're going to be hitting. And now think about it. Are your two bachi trying to hit the same point on the rim, or are they hitting just two arbitrary points on the rim? Depending on how your group plays it, maybe it's supposed to be that way, but for some groups, they're trying to hit the same point on the rim, so please try to have that be reflected in your mental representation. Okay. Just try here. Dong, 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 ka, da, ka, ka. Now, of course, I could cheat, right? And I could just play way over here. Now I have no danger of hitting the taiko because I'm like 2 feet away from it. But that's why the goal is to try to come as close to hitting without actually hitting as possible. If you think about what I said with the tip of the pillow, before I said that, okay, of the times that you don't get the hit you desire, half the time it should be on this, you know, like too high, and half the time it should be too low. What I'm saying here is that actually, instead of having the center be exactly here, make the center like the teeny bit above it, so that actually you hit in the air more than you hit the actual drum. But don't make it like so far above it that it's too easy. You see what I'm saying? So you should actually make a mistake. You should actually hit this sum, but try to reduce that. And this is cool because you can think about different parts of the piece. And you can think about like for what parts of the piece am I, is my mental representation not very well refined? Like perhaps on a fast part, or perhaps on a syncopated part or something like that. Maybe, I mean, that's weird, right? Like the syncopation is about like the music of it, right? But that can increase your motor error. And so that's why this is really valuable to do. You know, for some people like sit don, 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 karakaka, or do, kado, kadon, don, karakaka. If you take different rhythms, you might notice all of a sudden that now, like even though I could just barely not hit the points that I wanted to hit, on simple don, 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 kara, kaka, that like once I start doing doko kara, don, 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 or what have you, that like all of a sudden I airbachi fail a little bit more. So taking this to extremes, part of the reason I think this is so valuable to do is I remember when I was first learning pieces like Jack Bazaar or Square Pusher or Yodanuchi, basically like, I don't know, maybe Naname is an extra challenge to me because it's already like slanted. And so I have to think about everything slanted instead of flat, like Hachijo or Odaiko or Beta, right? Like I have to have a good representation of the slant. That's difficulty number one. And my body has to be like to the side, right? I can't just say, ah, center is probably fine, right? I have to have like a good consistent representation. That like with pieces like Jack Bazaar now, or Square Pusher, right now I have to have a representation of here, 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 maybe here, some keypad stuff, right? It's like, it starts to get pretty crazy. And like when you're practicing Square Pusher or Jack Bazaar, like when you're practicing a piece like this that has a lot of different things you're trying to hit, maybe multi-drum, Shime Okedo, stuff like that, where you have a lot of different points that you want to be able to hit, I really think it's helpful to do this kind of imaginary practice, both maybe like with the real drum there, if you have the opportunity to sometimes, but even without a real drum there, and to try to develop more realistic mental representations of where the drums are. So that was the thing that I wanted to say about airbatching matsuri representations. Cool. Alrighty. Any questions about this stuff? I would like to switch gears to our last thing. And this is where the danger warning needs to be applied. Feel free to pipe up if there are questions, but I'm gonna talk for a little bit. Okay, so I'm a very empirical person. Like, I like math, I believe in it and everything. And by the way, I should say that the kinds of things that we've been talking about with feedback systems, and also there's elements of reinforcement learning in here, you know, using things like pain. So we can use like pain to make us not to do something. We can also, you can't do this in most studios because food isn't really allowed, but theoretically you could eat a potato chip every time you do something right. It's actually like your brain does work that way. If you reward yourself, really, it works. It's easier. It's worth trying. Like if you're really, really frustrated trying to learn something, like get your favorite candy and eat it every time you do it right. You know, and you can do that while you're practicing at home. Nobody's going to be upset that you have food next to your drum or anything. But, you know, so thinking about all of these things, as a scientist, I'm really interested in putting ideas to as harsh a test as possible, just to see if it's really right. So I'm very nervous about this, but I don't know, it works on me and it's worked on a few other people, but I'm gonna try sharing this with you. So here's the idea. I am very bad at tossing bocce. Like, I don't think I've ever done a bocce toss in a performance. I don't know. It's just not my style of flashiness, but I know many of you have, and I know, you know, they look amazing. But I thought about it and I said, you know what? There's no reason that I can't toss bocce. Like, it should be that I should be able to learn this, right? Everything that I've just told you about fast and automatic skill development and learning says that my body must be capable of learning how to toss bocce. I can't just be like, well, I'm not a bocce tosser. Like, no, everything I told you means I have everything I need to do this myself and to get better at it myself. And so, you know, I did what most of us do when we start tossing bocce, is I find a bed or like a space. Let's just leave this over here.
I think you muted yourself.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. I was just saying that I was trying to spend a rainy afternoon tossing bocce and trying to figure out how to get better at it. But now I want to take everything that we've talked about today and put it together to try to come up with a way to learn how to toss bocce faster. So here's the idea. I thought, you know, pain hurts. And if I keep throwing my bocce and failing and hitting myself, I bet I will start trying to toss it correctly more. So under that logic, I decided to toss bocce with my eyes closed. Okay, blind bocce tossing. I see a few looks of consternation. Yeah, that was how I felt about it initially, but I was like, well, I'll just try it. I have a rainy afternoon. Let's just see what happens. And what I learned was really, really surprising. I found that kind of like when I shut my eyes in the balance exercise, that actually one of the things that changed is that I stopped trying to throw the bocce using visual information. And once I got over the fear of throwing the bocce with my eyes closed, I realized that how I was throwing the bocce changed. So then what I started doing was I started taking videotapes of myself throwing the bocce. So I'm gonna, basically what we're going to do for like the rest of this class period, as it were, is we're gonna practice throwing bocce with our eyes closed. But before we do that, or for a bunch of time anyway, before we do that, I wanna show you one of these videos. This is from like 2012 or something. You may not even recognize me, I had really long hair. And you can hear the sounds of the rain. It's, you'll see. So I've decided to like do some half tosses and whole tosses, and I've gamified the situation by trying to toss in a pattern that reflects either Renshu or symmetrical soundscapes, which I was learning at the time. I don't remember which one. It's one of the two. Sorry, all the videos look the same, but let us... okay, maybe the audio won't work right now. Okay. Can people see this? Cool. My eyes are closed. Okay, now I've just opened them real quick. Okay. Stop share. Cool. So, I mean, I don't know, to me that was quite a lot of progress to make. Like, I would never have thought, well, if I close my eyes, it'll actually make me a better bocce tosser. But I feel like I learned an important lesson that day. Oops, I need to plug my computer in. Okay, sorry about that. And it was my logic for why I wanted to do it was wrong, of like, oh, well, the pain of the bocce hitting my hands will make me do a better job. And instead of that kind of reinforcement learning thing, what ended up happening was it was more of a sensory feedback issue of I started trying to throw completely differently. And so now when I am trying to practice a bocce toss, say, I don't know, sometimes I do it. It's in some choreography that I'm learning. If I'm not getting it, one thing that I'll do is I'll stop trying to look at my hand or my bocce, or like I'll just shut my eyes while I do the toss. And I found it to be a really effective technique. So let's please take some time to close our eyes and toss our bocce. I'm gonna watch you all. Please feel free to unmute and ask questions if you like during this time, but we'll take maybe like 5 minutes or so, and try to think about like how you're doing right now. See how many you are dropping at first, and then say out of 10, and then once you've been doing this for a few minutes, count again and see how many out of 10 you're dropping. And for those who haven't tossed bocce before, I should say, if you've never tossed bocce before, please start with a half toss. So here's really helpful to have bocce that have tape on one side or a marking on one side. So if I just do a half toss, then I want to alternate between holding the tape and not holding the tape. Sorry, I'm looking, so these tosses are all terrible. It's much better when I close my eyes. Like, this is with my eyes closed. This is with my eyes open. Yeah, and I miss a lot more. So. Those of you who have someone else in the room, or if you have another device that you can set up, one thing that you can do, which we would have done if this were like an in-person meeting, is we would split into groups and we would have half the people toss and the other half take video of them on their own phones, and then the other half toss and take video of them. So if you want to set up another phone real quick, right hand was a lot better. Yeah. So I'm reading the chat real quick. Okay.
Yes.
Cool. So one thing that this can be really helpful in is, so when I was looking at those videos, I know we didn't watch it for a super long time, but I have like 20 of these videos of me trying to toss bocce over the course of that rainy afternoon. And I really noticed that my right hand and my left hand were trying to toss differently, which with my eyes open, it would have taken me forever to notice that. So the cool thing about video is, as I mentioned earlier, it's a sensory modality that it lets you get that visual information, but at a different time. So you can evaluate that sensory information when it's not going to distract you and let you like do a bad toss. So with me, right is much more consistent, we have someone saying on chat.
Your planarness.
Yeah. I think I should make it a game where, like, if I drop both a bocce, we have to trade off.
Well, then you'll get less practice.
Oh.
It's like if you get it right, you have to trade off. You're not allowed to trade until you get it right.
Exactly. thinking about the motivation. Right, see, because the problem is that you could just... I mean, if you think about it, like, why should it be the case that with my eyes open, I don't do as good of a job tossing? That's pretty strange, right?
Yeah.
Like, the idea here is that if I remove information, it's allowing me to focus somehow.
Yeah, it seems like it's counter to all the advice that you just gave us about precision, right? But what it's doing is forcing you to use other senses. You're making your throw more consistent because that's the only thing you have to focus on, I think.
I think that's part of it, but I would like to think that also, so remember what I said earlier about with the balance, how we have multiple sensory streams going at the same time, so we have multiple feedback loops, the feedback loops on feedback loops. I think that this has to do with the time delay, actually, of the kinds of feedback that we get. So, and that actually this is a case in which visual feedback is too slow, whereas with our hands, how we're doing the throw and how we're receiving the catch is so fast, that tactile sense, because it's right in our hand. So I think this is a situation where actually the visual system is slowing us down and there's too much time lag. On interpreting the angle and the 3D position of the bocce is actually too slow compared right. to the feeling in our hands.
When you learn to juggle, one of the things that they say is that you should be able to catch the ball with only this tiny little window of visual information.
Ooh.
Right now, part of that is about getting your throw to be more consistent, but part of that is reading the complete trajectory of the ball from just a tiny little piece of the arc. Because if you're juggling three balls, then there's all the time in the world while that ball is in the air But if you're juggling five balls, the amount of information you have to process before the next catch is a smaller and smaller window. Right.
Oh my goodness, I want to talk to you about juggling so much right now.
I'm not really a good juggler, but I've talked to jugglers about how they perceive it.
Yeah, yeah. I think there's also there's some related work where this was done with people about perception and expert use of perceptual information, that that when you have people watching basketball, novices, people who don't themselves play basketball, they like watch the hands and the ball as a person is trying to make a three-point shot, and that people who do play basketball, they watch the hips and they watch the follow through, like they're looking at the body, they're looking at this, just like a Taiko player.
Right.
And if I'm trying to give someone form feedback, I'm looking deeper and deeper into their body instead of looking at their sticks in terms of trying to diagnose problems with their hips.
Before.
Yeah, that's a really cool insight. Thank you. So yeah, that's a cool thing to try too. So you can try like blinking your eye open really fast, mostly closed, but like blink it open real quick. It's just like flash. I have a flash of information. What does that tell me? So you can, right. These are ways of, the way that I think about it. Person in Aaron's house whose name I don't know.
Sorry.
Jake. Oh, okay. Hi, Jake. Okay. Oh, I see you're Jake. Got it. All right. Yeah, the way that I think about it is that like the sensory deprivation of one of these feedback loops is letting me focus on investing my learning algorithm sort of on the tighter time feedback loop.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Any other insights here?
I have an observation.
Please.
And I've never juggled before or tried twirling, so I'm completely a beginner. I notice when I am not looking, so I've closed my eyes, that my hands are staying exactly the same. I'm waiting for it to come.
Uh-huh.
But if I open my eyes, I'm trying to move while it's moving.
Yeah.
Probably making it harder. So that's just like one of the things I can tell I'm doing.
Thank you so much for bringing that up. This is another kind of isolation, right? So now we're still like really with our eyes closed. You're right. Effectively, we're trying to solve the problem of throwing a bocce from one point in space to one point in space, as opposed to merely throwing the bocce and catching it somewhere, right? Which I guess naively is what we assume the task is, but that actually isolating the throw, which it's easier to do with one's eyes closed, helps us become better throwers. And then like we can solve the harder problem of throw here, catch there, which, so for those of you who've done a lot of bocce tossing, that might be a cool thing to try, right? How can I throw? So like, I'm not gonna try it right now because I'll probably break my computer, but like, how can I throw from here and then catch higher, or throw from here and catch here. With my eyes closed, to be clear, right? I think that has a much greater danger of breaking a finger, so please be careful. Just because when you're wrong, like, I don't know, you'll hit all over yourself, but yeah. For me, I was surprised. I actually hit myself a lot less when I do this with my eyes closed. I have some questions, especially for some of the expert tossers in the room. Yuta, what are you doing? Are you doing this with your eyes closed? It looks like you're like hitting the bottom of the bocce to try to get it to rotate more times. I can't hear you. You're muted. Okay.
Okay. I'm trying to do a reverse bocce toss. So this is upwards and then like the other way around.
This way. I see.
And then I'm trying to close my eyes. And then I was like, oh, maybe I could combine it by hitting it. Maybe. Yeah.
Cool. You're doing this with your eyes closed right now?
Not the hitting one. I did the forward one with my
eyes. You can do the hitting one with your eyes closed too. I mean, like, don't go to the hospital or anything, but yeah. Cool.
I'll do
it. Is it working for you? Is doing this with your eyes closed? Is it?
Totally.
Yeah? Oh my God. That's so crazy. Yay.
No, I think so. This is cool.
This is awesome. Okay. So does anyone else want to share their insights about this exercise?
Yeah, I guess I noticed like the variety of different ways to kind of fail a bocce toss. And aside from simply just dropping it, because there were tons of the left hand where it's like clearly it didn't make contact at all. But like the different kinds of like, oh, I caught it, but like I caught it here.
Yeah.
Or like I caught it up here, you know. And that's another kind of like, oh no, clearly my zero is like catching it right here, like in where my regular grip would be, so that I don't have to shuffle around.
And the nice thing about doing this, which I think, you know, as much as I was, I think in this case, I ended up being wrong about pain being what would motivate me to learn faster. I think those near miss catches, did motivate me to learn faster, like on the order of minutes, how to do that toss better. Because every time you just barely miss it, like that itself, like that is an output that gets fed back in, right? The difference between where you wanted to catch it versus where you did catch it. And so then your brain just automatically builds a feedback loop for you on that to try to reduce that error to zero. And I think that's one of the reasons why this works. Yeah. Any others? Cool. Okay.
I caught myself feeling a bad throw and opening my fingers wider because I knew it wasn't coming down where I hoped it was going to come down, right? So it was like, that's not going to be good, right? But I got it with the tip of the finger. But I knew at the throw that it was bad.
Yeah.
Which I think is interesting, right? Because you're focusing on, it was just like, I got the release and it was like, oh, that's not good.
Yeah, right? You're like, oh, it's not going to go well. That's right. That's right. Yeah. Yeah, just again, don't break a finger with that because like, oh, let's spread my finger. Sorry, I have once broken a finger not doing bocce tossing.
Yeah.
That's a really good insight as well. Any others? Okay. Well, one thing that's a bit of a latte tradition that I would like to continue to do is to give everybody 10 minutes of time to practice on their own anything that we worked on today. I mean, theoretically, you could practice anything you want, but this is just in part to, you know, like sometimes I use this time to like consolidate some thoughts in my notes that I didn't have time to write down earlier, just whichever thing I was most like, I almost got it or something, like basically just anything we worked on today or anything related to that you want to work on, let's please take the next 10 minutes to do, and I'll just sit here and watch you. If you want to talk to me about some of these things, it's also a great time to do that. We can, yeah. And so even if I'm talking to someone else, like please feel free to continue practicing whatever you're practicing, and we'll come back together in about 10 minutes. So normally I would use this time to practice too, and I'm very jealous of this time, and I get mad at people if they interrupt my 10 minutes of free practice. But because I'm the instructor, I will take a bullet and I will be here for y'all instead. So I'll just sit here. And if you need help coming up with a thing to practice and want to talk about, what did we do today? Like, come on over.
I have a question.
Yeah.
The pang sound, mm-hmm. is that like a flat hit with the...
I totally failed to say. I'm so sorry. Yeah, so it's like if I hit a don versus if I hit a ka, like you can imagine that there's... So if this is an angle for a don and this is an angle for, this is for a ka, right? Like you can imagine like a full range of angles in between that. And so when you're hitting like really perfectly flat, that's a pang. I tend to have better luck doing it when I use my hands to initiate a wrist snap like this. Like I find that getting a good pang requires a decent amount of speed and force and stuff, but yeah. So, and like this is another one of those good like distributional things, because like sometimes people will fail and do a dega sound and sometimes people will fail and do a ka. And so this pangs, dangs, gangs, whatever kuchishoga you want to use for them, they are an excellent thing to practice a lot of. So that you can get them as consistent as possible. And as we said before, you know, yeah, like.
Right, cool.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So on the pang, do you try to hold it down, or are you, is it a single flat hit and come back up the ladder? Okay.
Yeah, it's not a press hit.
Okay.
Good question. Really sorry I failed to explain what a pang was. My bad. Sorry, everything's fine. Okay, we'll probably come back together in like 30 seconds, a minute, something like that. So if you can finish up what you're working on, please come back. Okay. Are we basically back? All right, hopefully people start filtering back. Okay, cool. All right, so that's basically the stuff that I wanted to share with you today in talking about feedback systems. I wanna let you know that originally when I started working on this, I thought like, oh yeah, let's like teach this, let's do a workshop. And just the amount of material I had just kept growing and growing and growing. And I was like, oh my gosh, I could teach like a biweekly seminar on this and take a whole like college quarter. So I tried to spread it out over a 6 week or six session thing. So today was feedback systems. We also will be talking about mindset and optimization. So today, we talked about driving an error signal to zero. That's a kind of optimization. And there's other kinds of optimization that you can do and that your brain automatically does for you. And that sort of knowing that, we can use that for clever drill design or just really good, diligent use of our practice time as we tried to do today, getting really into the weeds and getting very nerdy about our hits and the precision sorts of stuff today, right? And we'll also be talking about learning and memory, which often comes up with, say, sequence learning, like when you're learning a song. And we'll do some drill design stuff. So one thing that I hope to do is for people to bring what they would like to get better at. And, you know, that could be, it could be singing, it could be dancing, it could be facial expressions, it could be shimedaiko stuff, it could be, you know, it could be very broad or it could be very specific. And what I would really love to do is to do sort of a breakout rooms thing and get people to help each other using kind of the cognitive and computational principles we've been talking about like how can we solve the problems that we have in our life, solve our learning challenges by designing really, really tight drills that are gonna give us access to really good feedback signals and help us push our error rates to zero, as it were. So we'll be doing some like active drill development. What else? We'll be talking more about learning and memory representations. The session will end with, the series ends with some sessions on composition and choreography and teaching and leading practices and so on, and how these ideas can be used to really make an impact on your repertoire or on how you perform choreography, dynamics, because it turns out there's all sorts of cool auditory representations or visual representations that the audience has. So it's not just you as the teacher or you as a learner, but also you as an audience member. And what kinds, like how can we make things easier to learn? So how can we teach better and so on that I think are sort of like cognitively informed. So now that we're done with the advertisement, I hope that people will give themselves a homework assignment of something to work on. So we did the 10 minutes of practicing on our own, but I really hope, the point of the homework assignment is to focus on one of the things that we worked on today. And really over the course of the next week or the next couple of weeks, whether you choose to, you know, to go on with this series or not, that you'll really like make a commitment to try to improve that thing. And that you'll try to like design drills or do the drills that we've been talking about to try to say, make that motor error smaller on your hits or something like that. And feel free to please, you know, check in with me or maybe check in with others in this workshop as sort of study buddies, as you're working on these things. So please use this as motivation to develop sort of homework assignments for yourself. And yeah, with that, I want to thank you all so much for, you know, bringing your energy on a Sunday afternoon to this workshop and bringing your questions and curiosity. I'll be around for, you know, a few more minutes to, you know, we have like five more minutes of the time that we had reserved, and I'm happy to answer questions. But yeah, thank you all so much. I really appreciate it. This is really fun. Can I unmute everybody? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unmute all.
Yay.
Okay. Yay.
Yay, this was really fun.
Yeah. Hey, thank you. Negative feedback's okay too. Remember, I love negative feedback. You can also socialize amongst yourselves, whatever. It's just, it's like end of class time. So,
yeah. Go get dinner.
Yeah. You eat dinner so early, Yuta.
No, I don't. We get a beer.
Early where we go.
Ready for dinner. Yeah, we're on the East Coast, so.
Oh, that's right. That's
yeah. Excellent. So it's certainly, yeah, we worked up an appetite for you all. That's right. Yeah.
This is awesome. I'm really excited about this course.
Yay. I'm going to send everybody a follow-up email. It's going to have, so like I said, I'm making a Google Doc full of citations and like more resources that people can follow up on. If you have resources, I know like quite a few of you are electrical engineers, so this is very, or just engineers of various sorts, so this is very nerve-wracking for me. And also like most of you, as far as I know, like I've seen many of you perform, you're amazing Taiko players, so like I'm like, why am I teaching you this? You're already great. But if you have ideas for resources, and you know, even ideas for exercises and things to do, things that this makes you think of, like please, you know, write to me, share. And also in that email, I'll have like a 3-question survey, and the questions will be like, what was your most favorite thing? What was your least favorite thing? And like, what was the biggest thing you took away, or something like that? Yeah. So, you know, it won't be like 20 questions of wasting your time, just really focusing in on, kind of the things that mattered most to you. So.
It's awesome. What are your thoughts on timing? So as far as like, let's say you're doing the thing today with bocce flips. So like how long to be keeping yourself in that headspace, and then how many times to repeat that during the week, or that kind of, in terms of making a practice schedule for yourself or setting goals?
Okay. So yeah. I think that spending a decent amount of time, like with some good water breaks or like walk around, so there's this concept of spaced repetition, which we'll talk about a lot in workshop number 3 more so. But yeah, I think you're getting at this idea of like, yeah, I want to do this as a regular thing. I want to do this as homework. So I would say that trying to bunch up all of your practice on one day is actually not optimal. So if you can do a little bit each day, that's pretty cool. I think with something like this, that actually like spending a decent amount of time on it in a session is probably reasonable. Like, I didn't mention this, but like using lighter bocce can be helpful, because if you are like, as you're starting to do more, adventurous things, like when you get a bruise because your bocce hit your hand, if you do this with heavy oak bocce, it's just going to make bigger bruises. And also the throwing dynamics are different, but as you get more comfortable with it, you can try different woods and, you know, you'll notice different things. But so I would say, like, I mean, I don't know. I hate to say this, but like, experiment with this, see what's working well for you. I mean, the reason I say this is because like the more you're able to, and this gets into some of the mindset stuff for next time, like the more you're able to have a realistic idea of how much progress you've made in a short period of time, I think that's really helpful for helping guide your own design of your practice schedule, your practice regimen. And so like, I feel like I could say something, but it's kind of like notes, it's very personal. And so I'm worried that I would say something that's personal for me. And like, maybe you have a lot more bocce flipping experience, and maybe you don't need
quite what I need. So yeah, and so that's why I said, like, the point here is to be like just really empowering ourselves to take an active approach to our learning process and realize that, you know, you're right, there are, you know, there may be something that's optimal for us. And in this case, rather than stress about, is this the optimal thing, try to actually observe whether it's working for you. Yeah. And yeah, please feel free to stay in touch with me about how that's going. If you're like, well, I made a little bit of progress and then I made a bunch of progress and then I made a little bit of progress, but I didn't change anything. What happened? Like, you know, oh, these are interesting questions. Like, you know, what was there, like a cool block that you pushed through of some sort of, like, you know, something all of a sudden got a lot easier, or like, I don't know, like, not all learning is linear. Yeah. So, like, often you learn really fast and then, like, you know, it's sort of an exponential or logarithmic curve of, like, learn really fast and then, like, you start to get diminishing returns. So definitely, like, when you're starting to notice diminishing returns, that's a good, like, where the like per trial or like per incident improvement is decreasing, that's at least a time to, like, stop and go take a walk, eat a potato chip, or go pet your furry friend, or, like, have a conversation with someone and then come back to it and try again. But I do find that coming back to it and trying again, like, it's amazing how much better things are, whether I'm trying to learn a song sequence or a complicated drill, or even just getting better at a motor repetition thing, like a motor precision thing, that, like, taking a break, for some reason, it can really help. So, yeah. Sorry, Eileen, I was laughing at you earlier because you were spinning around with a dog in your hand and it was really cute. Just so people know why I was laughing. I was not laughing because someone failed at something. It was because someone was doing something very cute.
Or, yeah, I had to go feed him or something.
Cool. Well, I'll stick around if there are any further questions, but I think it is, it is 5:02 p.m. my time. So please feel free to sign out. And yeah, thank you so much for your time. And this has been really wonderful.
Thank you.
Happy practicing.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you.
I just usually try to be the last one to leave whenever there's a Zoom call.
Could you please not do that? Because okay. I should be the last one to leave. Okay. Thanks. Yeah. Jen, are you even there? Oh my gosh. Okay. I'm going to go now. Jen, feel free to let me know if you want to say anything to me later.